A very, very warm welcome to you. And to note, a warm welcome to the Kenneth Clark Lecture Theatre. There's a point in that. But apologies that you have had a long climb up the stairs. We have a temporary malfunction of our lift. And we will make sure those who need lift at the end of the event, we'll make sure that you are led through to the gallery lift to go back down again. But again, a very warm welcome to the latest in our series, Contemporaneity in South Asian Art, a series that's been running for a few years now and is a context in which we enjoy discussions of all sorts on modern and contemporary South Asia. And it is a very, very particular pleasure today to have with us the esteemed painter Krishen Khanna, who will be talking on the Progressives group. And this group, this period, is of course one of the most intriguing periods of Indian artistic and cultural history. Krishen Khanna himself is the recipient of numerous awards, including the Rockefeller Fellowship in 1962, the Padma Shri in 1990, and the Padma Bhushan in 2011. And for those who would like to see his work for themselves in real life, as it were, as distinct from the slides we're showing this evening, it will be showing at the Grosvenor Gallery from the 11th of June onwards. But, and here are the links, this is not Krishen Khanna's first time exhibiting in London, nor his first association with Sir Kenneth Clark. But more of that later. Krishen Khanna now is based and has been some time in New Delhi. But it was not where he was born. He was born in 1925 in Lialpur in Punjab, which is now also known as Faisalabad, and the third largest city in contemporary Pakistan. He's a largely self-taught artist. He attended the Imperial Service College in Windsor from 1938 to 1942, and I hope we're going to hear a little more about that, where he took special classes in art. And then he enrolled himself in Government College in Lahore from 1942 to 1944. His family moved to Bombay during partition, where he joined Grimley's band and worked for 14 years with them. But to our great benefit, in 1961, he resigned from the bank and devoted himself to painting. As you will guess from that chronology, he has lived through extremely interesting times. And unlike the other artists we should be touching on today, his everyday was not exclusively dedicated to art making. There was his training at the Imperial Services College in Windsor during the last days of British imperialism, and then as a banker in Bombay shortly after partition, involved in interaction with different kinds of officialdom. The often surreal interface between public performances of authority and the vulnerability of individuals caught up in this larger rhetoric is a leitmotif of his art. And I think for any who have, at any point in their lives, or at any ages, and I think probably all of us in this audience have, in some way or other, had contact with authority, both in this country and in India itself, this book is one of the most sort of rather resonant aspects of his work. And we can see it throughout his work. From the paintings of the generals in the game series, which you see linked here, a reflection on the Bangladesh War, to the more cheerful depictions of vivid uniforms and the popular paintings of Bandhwalas, I mean, just from the 1980s, and I'll try and find some of them. I may have to go back, I'm not sure. There we go, they're the Bandhwalas. And again, this wonderful image of those wonderful brass band members in the images of the so-called masses, continually disenfranchised by the nation state. For example, this wonderful series of truck drivers, the truck series of labor from the 1970s and 1980s, as well as in a different mode and mood, the amazingly powerful Pietan series. Thus the effects of partition continue to loom large in Khanna's life as well as in his paintings. Today's conversation will address both his own importance to the national Indian dialogue as well as his relationship with the groups that has come to be known for spearheading the new art for the new nation of India, i.e. the Progressive Artists Group. PAG, or PAG, as it is fondly known, I don't usually myself use that term, was formed by six artists: F.M. Souza, S.H. Raza, M.F. Husain, K.H. Ara, Egade, and S.K. Bakri. Others associated with the group were Manish Day, Akbar Fadal Seh, Ram Kumar, and Tyeb Mehta. We have an error. Please correct this in the conversation. We got it wrong. Something's wrong there. It was founded in December 1947, i.e. just months after the 14th of August 1947 independence moment, which was also the partition of India and Pakistan, with the accompanying religious rioting and the death of thousands of people displaced by the new borders. The founders of the Progressive Artists Group often cited the partition as an impetus for their desire to set up new secular standards in India. Attempting to break away from the pretty Bengal school paintings of the pre-independence India, they forged an art that merged Indian themes with the formal properties of European modernism. Khanna joined PAG in 1949 at the invitation of M.F. Husain. I hope we've got that right. It gave two challenges. It's arguably best known member. He was part of a second generation of members, including also Gaitande and Mulansamant. And following the departure of Souza and Raza, the foreign shores, the group disbanded in 1956, but its legacy, as auction results, of course, as one example testified, lives on. This is Khanna's story and PAG. And I now very warmly welcome Krishen Khanna to join us at the table with Conor, Macklin, and Zehra, Jumabhoy, to talk to us about his life and experience, and particularly the early independence era. Please come and sit down. And could I just say that we will first of all have the conversation between Krishen Khanna, Conor, and Zehra, and then, if you'll bear with us, we'll then open it to discussion and questions thereafter. I will formally open it at that point.
So, Krishen, one of the first questions we'd like to sort of ask you is not really to do about the art, but it's all to do about politics. But clearly, the progressive art movement was not just the only progressive thing going on in India at the time. There was progressive theatre, progressive literature, progressive poetry. And we want to know is that there seems to be two factions arising here. One is the revolution, or the independence, you could call it. And the other is there's a strong sort of element of socialism. Well,
yeah. You know, when the group was originally formed, it only had Raza and Souza. Souza was the prime mover in all this, I might add. And he actually drafted the kind of what the group's all about, etc., etc., and the name Progressive was first given by Souza. Later on, he disbanded the connotation, because it was obviously a very political orientation on it, and he felt that really we were not a political body. We were and we were not. In fact, we were not going to be actually functioning as a political group like some of the other groups, like IPTA, for instance, was very politically oriented. But it was decided, I think, by these people, by Souza and by Raza, Ara, Bakre, yes, these were the original, and Gade, of course. Gade was there. Gade was really didn't have any political opinions on this subject, but these are the states to some extent, Souza most of all. And then of course he revoked this business and said that we are actually an artist group. Progressive stands for qualifies art and doesn't qualify politics per se. And now what at that time, because there was things happening in Bengal, for instance, there were a number of very important artists there. And I regret to say that even when I joined a year later, one didn't know too much about people like Vinod Bihari or any of the other, you know, the wonderful sculptors and so on that were there. We were, in other words, actually, the whole thing was very deeply internalized. And I think it had to be to pursue, because, and this is happening really only mostly in Bombay, and it was really, the orientation was in Bombay. Because what was happening in Bombay was that art was being treated like a hobby and pleasantries, you know, and went alongside sandwiches and parties and that kind of stuff. And it didn't have anything more substantial to see. And this is what irked these people. And they, quite rightly, I think, went in for something more serious and something more cogent, actually, and more relevant to the times that we were living in. Now, it's not very easy, nor is it, doesn't happen instantaneously, that the relevance of the painter or the artist to the times he's living in, that kind of adjustment takes a long time, and it's still happening. I mean, I think it's changed its course, of course, but it doesn't happen overnight. You can't suddenly make a declaration and say, well, this is what we are. And because all declarations are pretty stupid, and we never, the progressives never had a written thing about it at all. It was all word of mouth and people. There's one understanding, I would say, amongst them, was amongst the originals, that they had the opportunity to see if they found somebody suitable in terms of vision. In fact, somebody who was really pretty disgusted with what was going on, they could be, every painter of the group could co-opt one other painter. So Husain was co-opted by Souza. Later, Husain co-opted me, and it all went in a kind of a, like this, Samath came into it. I see his name is never mentioned. And he went to New York. But that's another story, how it didn't break up, but it pushed out, put it that way. So there was Samad, there was Gaitonde, there was Banu Rajapathya, who's never even mentioned, because she stopped painting after a while and went in for dress designing, and indeed did extremely well. I mean, she got a huge award when she did the dress designing for Gandhi, the film. But she stopped painting. At least she wasn't a part of the group any further. I mean, she didn't take any notice. Tyeb is often mentioned as a member of the group. Tyeb was in London at the time. So he came here. Padam Sikh came in at that time. So we had this show, the first show, with all these painters in a restaurant called in Delhi, Bombay. And Chetna was the restaurant. And it was in Chetna that all these pictures were hung. I still remember all the pictures, incidentally. And they were quite different to what people expected. In fact, when I joined the bank, within the first week or so on, I went in a lunch hour. I went to Rampart Row, which is where Bombay Art Society was, in a little room perched up somewhere. And so I clambered up the winding stairs, and I found two old ladies coming down, and they were saying, oh, it's absolutely disgusting. So this was my introduction to the progressives, you see, and it was Souza's exhibition at that time. And indeed I went in and Francis was there and we met, and, you know, casual hello and so on. And I saw his work, and extremely well painted, but the content was, he painted self-portraits, self-nude portraits, frontally. And this shocked the, naturally the old ladies were actually thrown off their balance. And so, soon after that, the police came in. And the police took a dim view of this thing and public decency and all that, which you can imagine. And they said, so he said, well, we'll sort it out, don't worry. And he covered up the offending parts. And there the matter ended. The paintings never came off, but they had these works, little pasted stuff on the, so the painting became sanitized as it was, you see. And however, that was that. I mean, whilst we are on the subject of prosecutions for indecency and so on, the other big event happened a little later, which was with Padamsi. He was hauled up for doing a painting which was called Lovers. When I met Padamsi, I went into his studio and the whole thing had blown over, I mean, being finished. And I was talking to him and he was giving me the details of this picture and so on and so on. So I said, where is the picture now? He says, well, there it is. It was just, I said, what's offensive about it? He says, well, it was the offense, as was mentioned, was he has his right hand on her left breast. See, so that was supposed to be bad, right hand, left breast, and all this kind of stuff. Anyway, it was a very normal, quite a well-painted picture. I wouldn't say it was exceptional or anything like that. But there was a big court case which went on. And then all the big wheels, you know, who were there in the world of art, and they came to his defense. And there was a big argument about defending him and whatnot. He was a hot-headed young man at that time. And he said to them, he said, well, all this talk is very nice to hear and so on, but will only those who are prepared to go to jail with me stay, please, otherwise. And then somebody who was very senior, who was a government servant, and he said, well, I'm a government servant, I'm sorry, I can't sort of say. To which his answer was, he says, we don't deal with servants here, we deal with masters. Boom. And the matter proceeded in court, and he won it. And it's one of those judgments which stands even today, that it was fought out and won. Large credit for this goes to a person like Rudy from Leiden, who was there. Now, it's not a digression, but it's quite true that Mr. Hitler had something to do with it, because all these people were pushed out, I mean, voluntarily, like Husain was, I mean, voluntarily, see? I mean, nobody pushes anybody out physically, but you create conditions which make it impossible to continue. So Rudy came out, Schlesinger was there, Vic and Walter Langhammer was there, Teddy Schinzer was there. Schinzer was, of course, in a big drug company and so on. But these people had a great influence on painters at the time. For one thing, they had all the books, reproductions, and these were made available to Skira reproductions and so on, a lot of them. And so these artists were given free hand to see these things and so on. And, you know, so we got to know what was happening in Europe at the time.
We were going to come back to that in a bit, because we have a slight structure. So we were wondering if... If you could tell us a little bit about how you joined the Progressives. And what
how
you
I joined? Oh, my joining was very simple, actually. I mean, it was all right. I'll come back to this later. But the, how I joined was when I went up, I saw Souza that day, and when I described what happened. And then after that, soon after that, there was going to be a big exhibition of the Bombay Art Society in the CJ Hall, the big hall there, of the Diamond Jubilee exhibition, as I recall. And Pulsiker was a painter who was a friend of mine, and Pulsiker was teaching at the JJ School of Art at the time. And he used to come frequently. And I had a painting, which I'd done, which was, I thought, it was straightforward. I mean, I saw these people standing, reading newspapers. I happened to be in Delhi when Gandhiji was assassinated. And when I went back in the evening, there were these islands in the roads, with the lamp, one lamppost, and the light coming down, and just reflecting off the whites of the air, then these figures emerging with the whites, So it was a strong composition, though I think it was feebly painted, but it was an impressive painting that way. And Pulsiker said, now the show is coming, you put this in there. So I said, no, I don't think it's a great painting. It's one of my things which I've done. I thought to go along. So he said, no, anyway, I'll take it away and we'll see, and so on and so forth. Then when came the day and I went there, I saw this painting hanging right in the middle of the exhibition, and then to the right, left were all those who became my great friends, It was, Souza was there with a painting called Golgotha in Goa, which is very symptomatic of what happened with him, actually. There was a painting by Heba, there was a painting by Gaitonde, lots of people, lots of my friends. Husain was in that. Raza was there. Raza got the award that year, in fact. And I later on told him that the painting was not very good. So he said, why didn't you tell me at the time? I said, I was scared. But these things went on. And anyway, after that, Husain called me up and said, can we meet? I said, sure. So he came to my little room, which I had on Churchgate, and we chatted, and he saw what little work I had done in Bombay itself. I was a sort of a hobby painter, painting in my spare time. Most of my time was dedicated to the bank. I had to. However, he was quite impressed and very friendly and so on, said, oh, we should meet further and so forth and so on. As he was leaving, he saw there was a book lying on my table. Clive Bell's Art, the great proponent for form, the formal attitude in art and so on. He said, Mayor, can I borrow this book? I said, yes, sure, take it. So he took it. And then 4 days later, I found a little packet waiting for me in my room when I came back, and there was a little letter. We used to correspond in Urdu at that time, So he said, I'll give you the exact wording. Urdu was, you won't understand it, but probably not. But he said, do accept this as a small token of my regard and so on. I lost your book, I'm afraid. I left it in the taxi. So in a way, this is what I think, that there are certain forces which operate at the right time. We had done with this kind of formalism, which was getting it was invading all the juices which are so important to art. You had form seemed to be the big thing to be painting, and you could dislocate yourself from everything else and just paint form because it's native. And this was Clive Bell's whole thesis of significant form and so on. Anyway, so it was then that Husain suggested me to be a part of the group, when I then became a member of the group. And simultaneously, Gaitonde and Samant became members. It was quite a Now, I'll tell you one thing, that we became, but really very great friends as time went on. But what really drew us towards each other was work. And it was on the basis of work that the group became cogent, became important. And the group never, you know, it wasn't a secret society either. People were built, artists and so on. We were mobbed by several people, Ambadas, Tyeb, all these people, and Ramkumar also. So, I mean, the fact that they were not officially members of the group didn't matter at all. In fact, later on, when Raza and Akbar and Souza left and they went to Paris, there were just a few of us left. But we still had exhibitions. We had two exhibitions after that, without these painters. You know, without Husain, of course, was there. Husain was there. I was there. I thought he was there. Other people were incorporated, like Hazarnis. Nobody hears about him anymore. He died. Gaitonde, yes. So we had several exhibitions. We had two with the progressives, and later on, there were very important exhibitions that happened, actually. There was one which was held in the newspaper building, INS building, and I came out. I was in Madras, and I just flew up for the day or something just to see this exhibition. I was sitting outside with Husain having coffee, and then the girl who was looking after it, she came running up to me. She said, there's someone who wants to meet you. So I said, yes, and will you follow? I said, yes. So I said to Husain, I said, you carry on with your coffee. I just want to meet this guy. Maybe he wants to buy a painting. Anyway, I went there and I was introduced to him. And it was Sir Kenneth Clark himself. And he said, and he was looking at these three or four paintings which I have up there. And he seemed to be quite impressed. And he said, have you shown in London, young man? So I said, no, sir, no, I haven't yet. So he said, well, you should. So I said, that'd be a happy day when I do that. It so happened, not too much time later, I think it's about 6 months later, that my wife had to come here with a son for an operation on his eyes and so on. So while the little boy was being attended to in a hospital room, my wife took those slides which I'd given her, and she made an appointment with Sir Kenneth Clark, and she went to see him. He was terribly nice, and he recommended Leicester Galleries.
Krishen, at that point, can I interrupt you again? Just to go back, sorry. I'm going to interrupt you again, just
yes.
To go back.
Yes, that's all right.
We'll come back to the Leicester Galleries later on.
Okay.
Now, I just wanted just to ask you, in terms of the progressive imagery.
Oh, yeah.
And,
yes, okay.
And Kaji, can you...
Yes, it's very important.
Can you just put on the image of the 1947 painting, Krishen painting? Because as Debbie points out, we now see the progressive as an important historical event and movement which fundamentally reimposed or reintroduced India with its own heritage, but obviously in a modern language. And obviously you can see this in the works of Husain and Souza. They spent a lot of time looking at classical sculpture, miniature style painting.
But
the question which I have is that, you know, if this was an artist group which was reflecting the times and obviously and all the humiliation of, you know, being a colony, etc. Where was all the violence? Where are the pictures of the British colonizers, for example? We there aren't any of these.
The thing is that I think that you're talking about the partition.
Yeah.
Well, the partition.
There is a picture here from 1947. this
oh, this is Satish. This is Akbar.
Yeah, of Krishen painting.
No. Which is mine. Yeah. Oh, that's a little...
The second one.
Even that's mine. This is mine.
Yeah, that's mine.
The dead tree. Yeah.
Death in Autumn, Lahore. It's a very, very evocative painting.
It is an evocative painting.
Painted in 47. I know Tyeb did the partition paintings division later on.
I did paint pictures, or rather I've been drawing a lot, which I've got. And I haven't sold those drawings. And I still haven't finished with the partition, because the partition was... it was a monstrous, terrible thing which happened, you know. And when one is afflicted with that kind of situation, you don't sit down and start painting it. You know, you've got to swallow the experience and let it metabolize within you. And then something, you've got to then be able to look at it with a certain degree of objectivity. And I think that's what creates a work of art. Otherwise, it's vomit. You know, you can just spill over and beat your breast. I mean, that's the same. But beating breasts isn't making art, is it? I mean, so I think that Satish, for instance, Satish Gujral, who was not a member of the group, because he was away, he went to Mexico. He painted pictures which were sort of agonizing and so on and all that. I'm nothing against the so-called illustrative element, which is much despised, you know, frowned upon. Because if the situation demands it, then you say it. If it really hurts you and hits you, then I think you have reason enough to be able to get it out of your system or whatever. You can't then be painting little comfortable still lives, you know. I'm still in the process of painting those pictures. And I've done a new number of drawings, and I'm planning to actually paint. I mean, I've seen this exodus. It was an exodus. And it was a horrible, horrible experience. And in terms of human tragedy, it was just terrible, you know. And one witnessed it, one saw it. And one was a part of it, in a sense, you know. So that's, I mean...
But you were wondering in some sense that, you know, it was a tragedy, but the sort of the relationship with Britain, with all of you all, was strange, because there didn't seem to be any anger directed at the British who, caused the tragedy.
Mm-hmm.
And then the sort of the coming to London and the sort of dynamic with criticism here and all the rest of it, it didn't seem like there was... directed at the British.
You know, the thing is I would say that there are certain experiences, you know, which are so deeply embedded in a sense that you can't think of them as excuses for art, for producing art. It's not an excuse at that stage. It's really nor is a shriek an experience, is an artistic experience. So it's very, very difficult to create a picture which is authentic, true to the times, and true to your own feelings at the time, you know, which is important. And then whatever form that comes out, whether it's so-called significant or not, it doesn't matter, you know. But I think all of that is certainly it's happening with me. I mean, I can really speak of this thing for myself. Tyeb was not a member of the group, huh? But Tyeb, in fact, used to come into meetings and so on, and quite apart from that, he became a very, very, very close friend. And by disposition, he was very depressive. he would always see things with a slightly long face. Not that he didn't have a sense of humor, he did. But he's always saw the tragic thing. But talking about him, actually, is quite interesting, because he was in London. And he was the one painter, Akbar Kadam Singh said this, He says, you've got iron in your soul. He wouldn't compromise at all, you know. He went through, he and his wife left their home with 7 rupees, 6 pence or whatever, 6 annas in their pocket. And that's it. And then it... See, one of the great things about the group was that it really took cognizance of like-minded people who were really interested in art. And the question of money didn't matter that much. It was given. It was somehow matters were formed, you know, and given. I mean, Tyeb was one of them. I mean, we did several people, several artists. Al-Ghazi was one who helped him a great deal, you know, but all of us did, you know, all of us pitched in.
In terms of the money, I was reading that as a member of Progressive, you know, if you had a sale, you'd have to sort of sometimes split those proceeds with other members.
Yes, yeah, I mean, you know, there were no rules. No. These things just worked. I mean, the whole thing was to let's carry on somehow, you know. And the accountancy was not important. For instance, I mean, and this is only not limited to us. For instance, Effendi, the Indonesian painter, he was passing through, and the group gave him a show. It was the only show I think he ever had in India, was in Bombay. And it was in the small artist, what is later became the Artist Aid Center. This room was, when the main Jahangir Art Gallery was made, this became, was made the Artist Aid Center, where, you know, Arai took charge of that and was pouring tea all the time. So, anyway, Effendi had a show there. And similarly, Harkishan Lal, who was a fine painter, really a beautiful painter, probably the first, I would say, just about the first time in terms of kind of Indian painting, traditional painting, which had received patronage and depended on who the patrons were and had approximated to that kind of taste, you see. This is the first time that there was no such thing. And he was painting rural scenes as well, but it's so beautifully painted. And I mean, and you talk about form, I mean, he had the form. I mean, it was really wonderful. And we had a show of his. Now, the group didn't have much money. I mean, R.I. used to go around saying, you know, we've got to show this, we've got to pay this rent, and so on. So one just logged out whatever you could carry on. But we wanted him to have a show, and he had his very beautiful show. Sold nothing. And we all felt pretty terrible. Then the group sort of said, no, I think what we'll do is the group will buy the painting. So we bought a painting, a beautiful painting called Connoisseurs. This is this prize bull being examined by all these yokels, you know, who are going to buy it or whatever, looking left, right. But it was he and Pranath Mago, I think, were the two adventurers in making a very definite link between Indian painting and European painting. European painting, I mean, Souza says so quite openly. He said he was very influenced by Rouault, his figures, the way he functioned. And Rouault, as you know, I mean, he was doing stained glass. And Souza took his cue, really, and also living in Goa, he had access to these churches and so on. And so he has this, but he also, I mean, just bringing in the Rouault into this thing wouldn't have made for a great painting. There was something else, I mean, his own talent. He was an extremely talented person and extremely well read. And he produced these paintings. I mean, and the show of his which I saw, there was Hokusai, there was all sorts of people, you know. It's very eclectic because everybody was eclectic. The German expressionists had a great influence. I mean, we're talking about the British Academy and the British painters and so on. Yes, there were some, but it was actually going out. It was reaching out to wonderful work done anywhere. And to that extent, it was opening out of the scene, you see. It wasn't limiting it to making a narrow group and making some sort of a statement, therefore. So that whole thing extended right down to this day. We still write letters to each other. Even when Raza was away in Paris, incidentally, soon after he got there, after his show, he got the Prix de la Critique. And it was Kausti Jangir who announced this in the hall to a whole packed audience. He was given a standing ovation. I mean, that was the thrill, necessity for art was felt so much, you know. And so everybody thought that they'd won out, you know, on this thing, not only Raza. It was shared, this whole thing. I think.
So, Krishen, so you talk about the this Europe and this big pull.
Yeah.
For artists and
yeah.
And as you say, obviously, you know, in India, you only study these pictures, you know, in a two-dimensional form. You never ever see.
The Japanese had it as well. Sure.
But the and obviously in 49, Souza left the Progressive Art Group and. I understand that there was some sort of recriminations or there was a bit of bad feeling about him departing for leaving the Progressive at that stage. It was shortly followed by Raza.
Huh?
Raza left in 1950.
Oh, but he's written about it also. Yeah. You know, he's written all the... I've got all his letters which he wrote on this subject. That
But obviously when these guys left... Was it a big blow to the Progressive group?
I think so. I mean, you know, Souza, not only to the group, but to everybody.
Yeah.
And because I think he was a wonderful painter.
And I suppose,
he was also very acidic.
Hmm.
And let me tell you, this is a very funny story. He just moved into Holland Park here. And I was visiting, and I'd been to the Edinburgh Festival. And I came back, and we had some wonderful music and so on. So I went to see Souza. It was a black hole. The room there still hadn't been filled up. But we sat and chatted and so on. And then we went to a pub nearby. He was still drinking in those days. Not too much, just a little. And he said to me, you know, there's an article, it seems, that was written in Marg magazine, being very critical of him. And it was signed KK. And we wondered who this KK was, you see. And he said that we really thought that the style of writing, that the standing of the man and so on, was Karl Kandalawala, who was very well known as a writer on miniatures and so forth. But Karl had very few things to say other than for Amrita Shergill. I don't think he wrote about any other painter. But he said, was it Karl? I said, no. I said, it was me. I wrote that article. And I'd been critical of Souza. And I said, then he suffers from too much thinking about himself and his, what he wants to do himself. And he doesn't have what Keats called negative creativity, that ability to hold back and let work proceed. Mark you, Souza was full of himself and all the time, but he also had a great sense of humor. He also knew who he was talking to, you know. So I said, yes, it was me. Do you agree with what I said? And he shook his head. yes, I think that's partly true. In another instance, when there was a big show going out to the States, big celebration, you know. So there's this painting, I had this painting, he'd seen it. And I had this painting which I called An Anatomy Lesson. And so this was a conversation with Rembrandt, actually, on his Dr. Tull. This was actually apropos of that, quite different. People were in uniform. It was a very aggressive kind of painting, and a black and white, quite a difficult painting to take. However, Souza says, wrote to me, in fact, he said, "You know, that's a nice painting you've done, that's very good. Well, you call it, it's got nothing to do with Rembrandt. If you ask me who it has something to do with, it's me." But of course it wasn't. I told him, I said, "You were never in my mind when I did this painting, I can assure you."
We were sort of wondering, you know how you said the financial success of the group wasn't really the objective, but did it affect the dynamic and the jealousies and, you know, whatever, when some people were successful? And Souza had very early success.
You know, I mean, he was a wonderful draftsman. And let's also admit, and he admitted it more than anybody else, that his draftsman was taken straight from Picasso. In fact, when Picasso died, he said, "Now I'm the only fellow left." So this was Souza. See, I mean, he was very good. But he also felt that he could do anything, and anything which he did was important. You know, and this is. I mean, he tells Husain, I'm opening Husain's exhibition. Husain tells me this. I wasn't there. He says to me, "There are still one or two things I can tell you about. I can teach you." So Husain says, "This, please go ahead. Let me have your instruction." But there was a great deal of humor in all of this as well. You know, there was. There was great camaraderie, and there was a big sense of humor, and a lot of very serious talk. Now, amidst all of this, I haven't mentioned one very important person, and that would be a fault if I left him out. I think it was Balchawla, who was the big cementing factor in all of this, you know. As I said, Baal didn't need the English language. He just said five words which could say everything, you see, by manipulation, by this, by his gestures. He was a great actor too. But he didn't paint, but he was always in the presence of painters. So Husain said to him one day, he said, "You know, you're with us all the time, why don't you have a go?" He said, "This is who that." So he had a go, and he produced wonderful paintings, to everybody's happiness, I would say, not annoyance at all. And a painting of his, there was an exhibition going off to Japan, and his Zabal was included in that. And I got the message that he'd got the governor's prize for this painting. So I was in Delhi, Bal was in Bombay at that time. So I called him up, and I said, "You've just received the governor's award for your painting, governor of Tokyo." He said, "Will you stop teasing me and stop this rubbish?" He says, so I said, "This is not rubbish. If you want to give the award away, you can tell me that, you know, I'll take it happily, but it's actually given to you." He said, "For heaven's sake, don't talk about it, you know. Everything's under the sheets there." He was petrified with this thing, until finally the president, or who it was, the Japanese ambassador, had to give this award, and so he came up for it, and with great temerity sort of went to receive this award. But Baal was a fantastic painter, and completely self-taught, but great influence.
Am I leaving something out?
We had some really nice pictures.
Yeah, please do.
You guys in the sort of the kind of critical circle of Rudy von Meeden and We just wondered about, you know, the scene at the time with sort of critics coming back and forth. And we could go back to that era.
Yes.
But also the, you know, the space that the galleries played and how these lines were really fluid.
Well,
lots of like really critical letters about, I found this gorgeous one about something to do with Keku Gandhi and Raza and you writing to each other, and Raza goes, but you know what, you mustn't treat him because you mustn't actually, you know, trust him, because after all, these are merchants, we are artists.
I don't know. But, I mean, as I said, the group actually broke, it didn't break up, it flowered out, put it that way, because Balu opened a gallery, then called Gallery 59, and the first show was only four painters, and it, there was... And that's a wonderful story. There was Raza was just coming from Paris and he had some paintings. Husain was there, and there was Ramkumar in it and myself. There were just four painters who were in this show called Gallery 59. And Gallery 59, and sorry, not Ramkumar, it was Padamsi who was there. And so a lot of people came. And probably it was the first big gallery.
Oh yeah, this is
the old Crows. a lot of people came to the show and showed it extremely well. Then Raza came with a load. This is where prices happened. Raza came with Paris prices for watercolors once. So I had left. I transferred to Madras, and I had about a dozen paintings or something like that, which I left behind with Husain. I said, I keep coming and so on, I don't want to carry some of these paintings with me. And so what happened was that Husain used my paintings and he painted over them. These were not very good paintings. So I didn't mind at all. And he asked me, he said, what do you think of my paintings? And so I said, this looks very interesting. It has a very nice substructure in paint, as it seems. So he smiled. He said, that's your painting. But anyway, the thing was that Husain didn't suffer, but he felt very strongly that another member of the group is selling his work at 1600 rupees. My God, that's a lot of money. And he was selling at around 800, 700, 600, you know, that kind of price. And he was very offended. So he said, what the hell does he think he is? He says, I'm going to sell mine at 5 rupees each. So I said, done, I'll buy the lot. Which he didn't like. But this sort of banter went on all the time. And then what happened was that the show was a sellout. When we all doubled our prices. I mean, I was selling at around 700-800 or so. And Ramesh Thapar and so said, you've got to push your prices up. He says, the bourgeoisie, because he was a communist, you see, he said, the bourgeoisie doesn't accept 800, it will accept 1600 is a much better price for them. So I said, okay, but what happens if I don't sell? Baal at that stage thumps his chest, he says, I'll buy the lot. You know, I mean, this is the kind of atmosphere which prevailed, you know, and it's very open, very aggressive at times, but it functioned. And he thought nothing. Nobody thought anything. But if a picture was badly painted, you said, this is rubbish, you know, not art, you know, without giving any offense. And that's proven by the fact that we remained friends, deep friendships between all of us, you know.
Because it seems to me that if you look at your work and other people's work of these the 40s and the 50s, there's a strong sort of there's a strong overriding sort of style which you could sort of call a progressive school type. Now obviously with the introduction of the European avant-garde, Raza adopting the god of Paris brush, you know, palette knife stroke, and Souza looking at sort of the grim post-war British sort of 1950s austerity, etc. That all coming out in his work. It kind of, you almost felt as though these guys were going off on their own sort of single path. They were departing from India. They were departing from Indian vocabulary and engaging with modernity. Now, the question is, you see, is that you seem to have also gone down this trajectory as well, with this sort of these 60s, the abstract phase, which comes from perhaps there's an influence Japanese work, which is an interesting phenomenon because obviously here you see what you've got because you know India being so close to China and to Japan, it has this sort of aesthetics of understanding which the West doesn't have. But it's interesting also to bring in the people like, for example, Morris Gray, who was an American abstract painter. Who actually organized the shows, your show, I think, in America, as well as your friend Guy Tondé. And you know, it's fascinating to see this, the your own sort of singular departure away from the progressive. Was that sort of cleansing or something, or what did that mission become contemporary?
The thing is, you didn't want to tread on the natural. It was a group, but the group didn't agree that it was going to paint exactly like each other. You know, there used to be there was a polemic which was going on all the time. See, Tyeb, for instance, was very critical of my work, and vice versa. We were the greatest of friends, you know. But I thought that Tyeb was stuck. He would formulate a theory and he was painting out a theory. He had excellent taste. I mean, he really did it extremely well. In fact, when he painted the first falling figure, I bought it in Kumar's exhibition. I still have it, you know. Then later on what happened was that his paintings then become theoretical exercises. And they, to my mind, move out of painting. They are there to illustrate what painting should be. See, and rather than treading into a difficult path, which was beset with difficulties and disaster, even sometimes, you know.
What was your drive to abstraction then?
No, I tell you, I believe, and now this comes down why this happened, because I've dealt in various things, including sculpture latterly. I think that. We imagine that we are creators and do this and do that and it's all born and we are, you know, geniuses or whatever. Actually, I think what happens is it's a series of events which formulate or assist in formulating the kind of action that you have to take. And now, just consider this. That I got the Rockefeller Foundation, the first one, to travel around the world and with my wife and then go back to America and show that and all the rest of it. Well, in Japan, I was taken to the, I met the Sumi masters and I was deeply interested in anybody's technique and certainly theirs, which is been done over years and years and years, the whole business of charging a brush, of loaning it, a fellow's thinking of the image, not what he's saying, and then the loading is done to that. And that fascinated me, the way the whole business begins, for instance. Well, I bought all his stuff. I got the brushes, I bought the paper and everything else. But I happened to be, we were then moving out of Japan and we went to Honolulu. Now, you know, we were there for 3 or 4 days, five days, I think. But after 2 days, I mean, how much of Honolulu can you take, you know, without doing any blood? So we came back to my room. And one evening I said to him, and the room was really just fitted in, the bed fitted in, and you had to sort of walls around, there was no other space, and there was the bathroom, of course. So I was forced into the situation of going to the bathroom with this roll of paper, not toilet, but this roll of paper and a pot of ink. And I thought, well, you know, I can have a go here, there's water, there's everything. So I never tried this in Japan itself, you know. So I laid down the ink on the bottom of the tub, and I pressed this paper on top of it and put some, you know, water in odd places and so forth. And I thought I'd let it dry, and then when I peeled it off, it was absolutely horrible. But what was fascinating was the remnant on the bottom of the tub. And I was inclined to buy the tub from the hotel. So from there began my investigation into Sumi painting. And I did it for 4 years. And I could have continued it forever.
And I believe a couple of museums acquired these works as well, is that correct?
Who?
Some museums acquired these works.
Yeah, the Museum of Modern Art acquired, then the museum in the south, the Demoniels Museum, they acquired, several people acquired it. It went down very well because it was so different to everything else. That was one of the reasons, and one could see it happening in America, for instance, in New York. Now, in fact, Miss a very important lady came up to my painting, Mrs. Dimonil, in fact, and she said, you know, the painting that they were buying for the museum, she said, I love this painting, I like this very much, and it's very difficult to be unique these days, which set me thinking that is the artist only interested in being a unique individual, you know? And in fact, if I considered my work to be unique, then I would have continued being unique, you know, trying, and every painting would then be trying to be unique. And this is not what art is all about, you know. I gave it a clean burial. That was my last show. I then had a show with Kumar in Delhi. But bringing the works which I had done till then, I had no addition further to that.
And how was the reaction of this sort of experimental work in India, whereas as compared to overseas?
Well, you know, Conor, who knows how this is going to work? I didn't know that this would go down that well in America. I was interested in how it was figuring itself out, you know, and that was interesting. And finally, you know, this big painting, I did this in a friend's apartment, not knowing again. I mean, he was going out to dinner. So I was staying with him. And he said, will you amuse yourself? I said, yes, yes, I'll manage. So I went in again to the bathroom, his bathroom. And I laid out, I cut out 5 sheets, large sheets of paper, rice paper. And by then I'd come to realize that what matters, you know, is the kind of paper, its absorbency, all of that matters very much. So I had the right paper and I laid out the ink and I laid out a small band like this on the side of the tub and a little more down the bottom and then a little way above. And I put in a large sheet, which is bigger than the tub, pressed it down. But not fully down, you see. Then I found that if I could press it down, I was creating rivulets, I mean little air channels throughout, and I needed to put only one drop on the side of the tank, of the bath, and just chase it with a drop of water, and I would have a line be drawn right over there, you see. Where the air bubble was. So I controlled my picture that way. And I produced this, ultimately, when I took out 5 of these sheets, I put them I laid the newspaper down in the sitting room, and I went, you know, each time I did it, I put it down there together, not knowing what it was going to be like. And finally, when I finished, the picture was ready made. right there in front of me. You know, it was a small panel with a large panel with interconnections. And I could have gone on. It was like a Bach fugue, in fact. And I called it that for a while. Then I could have gone on for miles doing this kind of thing, you see. That you create a form which just takes itself into action and then produces, can go on producing for a mile, you know, ad infinitum. So that was the painting. Later on it was sold in Bombay, in Delhi, and then the fellow didn't pay properly. He was a very senior man. Then finally I spoke to Sehare, who was 3 years later this happened, this battle went on, and I spoke to Sehare, and Sehare said, why don't you give it to the National, to the Museum of, you know, National Gallery of Modern Art here. I said, it's yours if you go and get it. So he got me to write a letter to the thing, and he went there himself, took a car and brought the thing back. Now, having brought, they were so stupid about it, they took it off the stretcher. It's a 10-foot long painting and on paper, which is mounted on canvas. It was rolled up, and he brought it back to Delhi. And now I kept saying, where's my painting? You know, I've donated it to you, and I've got all the papers and everything. Now, where's the painting? He said, oh, it's being dealt with. You know, so I kept hearing. Then Sehare died, and another chap took over. And I kept asking the same question, where's my painting? Finally, and this must have been like 7 years after the event, I said, I'm not budging from this institution until I see my painting. So the whole hell was let loose. They got old books out, and they're in the ledger somewhere. Yes, they did receive this painting, you know. And they rummaged and found out the painting as was delivered 10 years ago, all wrapped up, just kept there. And said, here's your painting, here's the painting. So when they did it, I had my heart in my mouth, because I thought this paper was going to crumble and everything. But fortunately, it was perfect, you know, just as was. And then it was stretched and framed, and there it is. They've got all the sumis up there now. So people looking at the pictures, just like people, they think that I did nothing but sumis, you see. Just like people who are seeing my bandwalas, they think I've done nothing but bandwalas. But this is what happens in painting, definitely.
Yes, we thought we'd bring the conversation back to London. And where's my question? Okay. Can you tell us about your experiences in London versus some of the others, like Souza and Husain, and also your very successful Leicester Gallery exhibition in 1960, and sort of some of the critical men who came, like Kenneth Clark, for instance?
I don't know what you said.
Yeah, well, basically just about the London shows and your experiences in...
The musicians?
No, yeah, the Leicester Gallery exhibition.
Leicester Galleries? Mm. What about them?
Your show there. your show there and its success. And
okay. I mean, the show went off very well. When I showed it Leicester Galleries after Sir Kenneth Clark introduced, and my wife took the slides, and it all happened, and the old man Brown looked at it, and he said, you know, these look very interesting, you know, and so he gave me a show, and then they were put up, and it went very well. Sir Kenneth himself came to the show when I was not there, and Herbert Reed came to it, John Berger wrote about it, and saw it. So it was well taken note of. And in fact, Sir Kenneth Clark wrote me a letter after that, which I still have. And he described one picture in particular, which I had called an elegy to Mohenjo-daro, which was the first abstract there, you know. It was freely painted. And he said, well, that's a masterpiece. He called it a masterpiece. And coming from him, I really thought I was in the cat's whiskers. Herbert Reed, on the other hand, suggested I continue painting and not think of leaving the bank, because then he quoted Milton, you see. That's it. He said, well, you know, You all just carry on painting and so on, but you know, don't leave the bank. You've got a nice bank to work for and so on and so forth. The interesting thing is that my friends, they were mad keen that I should leave the bank. And Raza put it in a rather typical Raza fashion. He said, "We'll make our own bank." You quit the bank. And I did finally leave it. The bank wouldn't believe that I'd sort of, when they saw my resignation, they thought I'd sort of screw loose on the, probably did. But anyway, I left it, and that day, Husain and Gaitonde and Balcharba, three of them came. They stood outside the portals of this great institution, and the clerks were having a tea party for me there, the final farewell. And they were saying, come on, get out. So finally, when I got out, first thing that Bal does is he takes my tie off. He says, "You won't need this anymore." And Raza, that very night, Raza was in Paris. He had a dinner party for me. It was a fantastic. I mean, what began as an interest in each other's painting, and painting mattered much more than personal relationships, you know. But they developed to such an extent that they really became very, very fast and very good friends, you know.
Well, it sounds as clearly all these shared experiences, you know, led to all you guys bonding very closely and, you know, developing very strong friendships.
Yes.
But it seems to me that obviously that after the progressive group has disbanded, there seems to be a rising sort of a stronger local economy in India.
Yeah.
And there were the artists who sort of stayed outside, who, you know, never kind of returned. Souza, for example.
Yeah.
And Mohan Samant, for example. Yeah. And even other artists like Chandra.
Yes, Ramesh died.
And you know, clearly, it took a while for even for Souza to re-establish himself amongst the Indian buyers, you know, or more recent buyers.
Yeah.
And particularly in terms of some like Mohan Samant again, who sort of became isolated from the Indian market. But you clearly, obviously being a resident in India, you had the advantage of wearing both hats, I suppose.
You know, for strange, I think it's a peculiar fact this, that the acceptance, for instance, in Britain and America and Japan and so on, and they were accepted. I mean, if you go by what the sales were like, and the galleries, and I showed with a very, very fine gallery in New York, and it just happened by an accident again, you know. Charles Egan. Egan was a very famous gallery at one time. I mean, every big American painter had been through Egan, you know. And so I thought, and he said, "I'll give you a show right now." I said, "No, not right now. Give me a year to prepare for it." And he did. And then we had this, he hung up the show. And he was a wonderful man. But, you know, the thing is that I don't think that the Indian buyer, to some extent, I suppose he is influenced, that a fellow who's traveled that much, seen so much, exhibited so much outside, surely this fellow must have some worth which has to be taken into account, you know. And so I think that the Indian buyers who've now come, they do take a more detailed interest. I mean, they're even advised by people who've studied the stuff, they're going to talk with them. It's taken a lot more seriously than ever before. I mean, before what? We had Rudy Schlesinger bought, from every exhibition he went, and Schlesinger bought a painting, and he was a wonderful man, you know, that way. Rudy von Leiden, of course, was the great spokesman for it all, and Langhammer, who was then the editor of the art side of the Illustrated Weekly, you know. They generated the spirit
of critical viewing.
So that leads on to the next question. Obviously there is a school of thought that the canon of international art of the 50s, for example, has long excluded artists of Asian or black origin. And obviously I know that Souza and Rashid Areen, so living there, they took this up with the tape, for example, many times.
Mm.
But despite the fact that Souza was in their collections in 1964. And so do you feel as though these artists were sort of overlooked somehow by sort of the institutions?
No, what I think has happened is that certainly the fortunate thing was, shall we say, the matrix was so placed that you had a bunch of very important French and other artists functioning at the same time. And they sort of forgathered in Paris. It was known as the school. They became, loosely the School of Paris. Now, for an artist, not to take notice of that would be absolute suicide, wouldn't it? I mean, it would be, why are we avoiding a situation which is there? From that emerges, there are other questions which happen. For instance, the European situation and the American situation has happened later. The American situation had a big injection of politics in it. Mm. It did.
But before we go to America, if you go back to the French model, because in the Ecole de Paris, as you say, it was a loose organization, but at some stage actually there were several exhibitions of the Ecole de Paris artists. And I think that Raza was invited to participate. At which point he was delighted, and I think he wrote to you in one of these published letters
talking about one of the
high points of his career.
Yeah.
However, if you look at the sort of the monographs which are published on the Ecole de Paris, there's no mention of Raza, there's no mention of Afandi, there's no mention of these guys.
But which monograph are you talking about?
The
ones abroad, you mean?
The ones published in Paris.
In Paris, yes, yeah. Sure.
They would have 20 pages on.
But that's very French.
Yeah.
See, it's very French. It's very American. Look, it's got something to do with an imperialist bias and something that you deal with that you produce. You are producing the tough ones, and the rest have to, if they follow camp, then they are very well accepted. You see, now if they fall out of line, then they will take the hindmost. I mean, then they're doing other things. After Raza got the Prix de la Critique for the kind of painting he was doing, there were several people doing that kind of painting at that time, including in Canada. Jean-Jacques, what's his name? He was doing almost interchangeable.
Yeah.
Now the what happened? Raza comes back, and he is painting tantric symbolism. And other than a few people who are interested in this language of the tantric, the rest wouldn't follow. I mean, he still remains, even when he's using, Tyeb and I talked about Raza, and neither of us agreed that this was the path to be trodden. But the fact remains that even these pictures which he does, they're extremely well painted.
But aren't those pictures also, isn't there an influence, not an influence, but there's a nod towards Frank Stella and the hard edge painting of New York as well? It's not purely about tantric art. He is putting them into a context.
Well, I mean, the Italian, the guys who come here and settled in India, the Italians who've been living here a long time, in fact. What's his name?
Clemente. No, I was referring to Frank Stella,
I've never fallen for him myself. I can't even understand why. I think, you see, a lot of this goes with talk and theory and ability to put across the theoretical exercises. And I think painting in America veered towards this. And Frank Stella, for instance, you're concerned with the edge, and then you're dealing with edges and so on. What happens to a guy like me who doesn't do edges anyway? I'm doing large movements. I mean, I can't be bothered. There's no edge. I'm dealing with a wholly different dimension, right? So I think this fact has to be taken into, and it is taken into account. I mean, I think, you know, anybody. Sorry.
No. This is lovely. I love that final exchange. Who cares about edges? I think it's a nice moment if we could to open up the.
Yes, of course.
The
I don't want to be speaking all
alone. And to see whether there are questions. But can I do a small question before, while you're thinking about your questions?
The women.
I mean, women in the group.
I think talking about the women in the group, I think there's one thing very important I want to say, really important, and that is every single painter has been supported by his wife or the partner he's living with. Every single painter I can think of. And if it hadn't been for the female support that he got, it would have been a very difficult proposition. And I speak for myself as well.
But no women actual artists.
No, there are women. Nasreen was a wonderful painter. I mean, she was like one of us. And much better. She was a wonderful person and a wonderful painter, I think.
But Raza's wife as well.
Janine. But Janine Mojila was a French painter. And she remained French. And she was a very fine painter.
Questions from the audience? Don't hesitate. The gentleman behind first, and then the lady.
You mentioned a painting, Golgothar in Goa, by Souza, as being particularly significant for Souza himself. What was significant about that painting as far as?
Well, you know, Souza painted all these pictures for himself. I mean, there were sort of images of them, of his own ego, of his own everything, you know. And he was, I mean, at the time that I first met him, like all of us, he was trying out different things. He was getting into world culture, and he writes about this. He says that, and why should one be restricted to, and our situation actually, in the Indian situation, at the time of partition, what were we? What was our legacy from the Brits? The artistic legacy was pretty dismal. And so the revolt was against them. You know, I think you asked a question about why do we hate the Brits? We don't hate the Brits at all. In fact, I've pointed out that we've three very important legacies which we've inherited. We don't talk about them, but we live them all the time. For instance, the language I'm discussing this whole with is being accepted and is widely accepted. It is also responsible for creating the total political unity of this country. It has never been as large as this ever before, other than in the reign of Ashoka, was approximating to this whole business. So we've got the language, which is local interests, for instance, which wanted to push Hindi into the foreground, as they're doing even now, never succeeded. They saw what happened in the South, for instance. It was a dismal failure. The other big thing is cricket. I mean, I'm not joking, but it's true. Cricket is, it's a legacy. It was born in England by farmers who would use their gate, says the wicket, and a danda to get the thing. There were these chaps who did that there, and look at it now. You know, I mean, I think nobody cares about anything more than they do about cricket. And third, My own particular obsession from the last few years has been the Bandwala, and the Bandwala is the direct descendant from the old, the Sunday after the Saab and Mem Saab had been to church, you know, they'd come out, there's the bandstand was there, and they'd listen to wonderful music that was going on and so on. We can't have a marriage today without the band coming in. So, you know, you there's no question of hating anybody.
I'm just you've been very fondly reminiscing about the dynamics between the progressive artist group. I'm just curious why it disbanded. Was it just a matter of all the artists traveling abroad too much, or what really caused the group to eventually dissolve?
Well, put it this way, I think during the period of the British rule, there were the what they did was making where these art colleges, JJ School of Art, then in one in Calcutta, one in Madras, and so forth. And the Royal Academy was the chief proponent in all of this, you see. And for instance, I was very surprised when I went to Thailand. I went to that art college, and it was an absolute duplication of what was here. You know? And so it is really when you break the circuit. And now the circuit actually is in the way you look at things. The teaching of art, and I was myself subject to this, that you are taught the coordination between what you see and the tips of your fingers and your hands and your arms that can emulate the figure or whatever you're painting there. So the coordination is between the eye and this, whereas a great deal of Indian painting and so on is the image that you have to see. You don't actually have to have a body sitting in front of you to do a drawing. Amrita Shergill, for instance, taught in the West, and she comes here and she paints Indian painter, Indian villagers going to the market, you know. And she's actually, they're not villagers to start with. They're her servants who have been there. And she's lined them up in her studio of fashion and she's painted them. Simple. It's transporting one technique, one thing, one location into another. But there's no change as such, you know. It's not what the image comes in. That's why I think this is one of the reasons why Paul Klee becomes a big hero in India. Because Paul Klee was there was a lot of imagination bordering on fanciful stuff also. I mean, everything he did wasn't that marvelous. But he moved away from this particular nexus of the eye and the hand and the actual drawing, you know.
Sir, and then this lady here, yes.
Yes, I'm very intrigued about the Imperial Services College Windsor and the fact that Raza is at the École des Beaux-Arts in Paris. Was there a situation where you chose, obviously it must be scholarship related or something, but what was the situation where you went to England and he was able to choose possibly the École des Beaux-Arts in Paris?
Well, there's a difference here, and the difference is that Raza was a painter already when he went. He was given a fellowship by the Orleans Francaise. And so he went there and he stayed there and worked there and was liked there and became a part of the French scene. In fact, there's a very funny incident which happened in, he came to New York, we were both together and we were interviewed by Hess, the critic. And so there was a painting of mine, the Sumi, which was there, and there was a painting of Raza's. So Hess didn't bother about my painting at all, because it's not a threat. But to Raza's painting, he looked at and he says, Écoute à Paris. So Raza then took two swallows in his, not yours, in his throat. Said a gout, and then said, yes, yes, yes. In other words, he was resistant to the fact being known, but he was that. But
what happened in Windsor?
In Windsor, I went to an English public school where they beat the hell out of me. So I did. I took art classes and so on, and I did for my school certificate. I did the usual thing, and I did quite well. And studied. I had to study the British art history, which I did. You know, and so that was fine. I also went to places. Now it's very strange that in the curricula, which was produced here in India and in all the colonies, in fact, Turner doesn't look in, nor does Constable, nor does Hogarth. Isn't that so? It's true.
Not now, but I mean, maybe then.
Well, then it was now. Maybe now the situation's changed. But I think that this was, that was so. I mean, those were the recognized facts at the time, you know. So I didn't go there. I joined the OTC. I was really down for the Indian Army. I should have been dead by now. but I don't know, fortune, see, you know, looks upon you, and they think, no, you're meant to be an artist. You see, then there I am, sort of beating it out now. So.
Krishen, could you talk a little bit about the role of memory in your work? Because you gave me a drawing 20 years ago of objects wrapped up and a man sleeping with his shoes turned upside down, and on it you wrote, "An ancient memory that won't go away and needs to be exorcised from time to time." Do you remember that drawing?
Whose drawing was that?
It was one that you gave me, one of your drawings.
Whose drawing? Mine?
No. In Hyderabad.
Hyderabad?
Yes, and they were object that had been wrapped up, and it was of that period, just at the time of partition, and you had written on it, "An ancient memory that needs to be exorcised from time to time."
But you know, I think that this is exactly the case where one has to concoct various symbols together to think that you're producing the answer. And actually you're not, because the actual replication of an experience, or the nearest you can get to it, is a very convoluted process. And the obvious statement of it, or putting things together on it, doesn't necessarily work out. To my mind, I mean, people are free to do what they want to, but that's where it stays, I think. I don't know if I've got your question right.
Perhaps you can talk afterwards.
Yes.
I wanted to pick up on something you were talking about earlier about Raza.
Yes.
Just the suggestion that he was as much influenced by Frank Stella's Tantric painting. Do you think that's... Was he situating himself in the Indian context like that? And
I don't think... Well, when he was in Paris, you mean? Hmm. I don't think that, no, in fact, at one stage he refuted the connection. Yes, he did. It was written about him, and in fact it was written about a lot of Indian painters, the painters, not a lot of them, but the people who were actually doing tantric work, like Santosh and others, Haridasan in Madras. Now these people were actually, they were taking the language of the tantric and putting it down in visual terms, you know, and which only they and other tantrics could understand. I mean, I can't, it's beyond me. But Raza was also then at the same time doing something like that, and he was called lumped in with this group, and he didn't respond well to that at all, you know. But later on now he says he's doing the stuff, what he's doing even now. I mean, and he has been doing it. He's accepting it as a great Hindu thought,
yeah,
you know.
I mean, because of Bindu and all his definitions of the Bindu and the Yoni, and I mean, it's exactly that language.
But I mean, the real answer is when you're looking at it without the verbiage, does it really sink in?
No, but that's because there's a limit to how many Bindus
something
you can
else,
do
something
they
else,
don't sink
something
in.
Something else sinks in, actually. The painterly quality sinks in. When I look at it, I mean, I my spirit doesn't go high. But when I'm looking at it, I'm amazed at the kind of the variation that he gets in his color. It's fantastic. I mean, he's still a beautiful painter, you know. He says the Bindu, the circle, it's the bija is the seed from which everything else grows. But it's not a tree, you know. For it's only a painting, and it doesn't. Yes.
Hello. Thank you very much for your talk. I wanted to ask, actually, during the talk, you started to mention something about miniature paintings, and I was wondering if you could kind of say a little bit more about that. And is there a relationship between your works and miniature paintings? I was thinking that, especially as I was looking at your series from 2000s.
I don't know that I understand your question, frankly, but I think really the whole business of painting is so complicated that anybody who theorizes on it, he believes in it and can do it, and there's nobody can stop him. I mean, that's the way it is, whether it's right, wrong, or whatever. I mean, what's there to stop anybody from doing what he wants to, you know? Except that nobody would want to buy it, I suppose. Yes?
Amelia. Yeah.
Thank you, Krishen, for that wonderful talk. I wanted to ask you a little bit about those two paintings which were shown. I think one of them was called Landscape in the Hall, and the other one was...
The tree one.
Oh, the tree one, yeah. Shall I tell you the truth about the tea one?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah.
It comes from Sutherland.
It comes from Sutherland?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. I was very interested in... you know, it's breaking down... Actually, what it is doing is...
This one.
It's breaking down of local colour. This is what it is.
And the other one, the previous one, the massacre at Tara Devi.
Oh, the Tara Devi,
yes,
no, then I'll tell you.
Can I just
the Tara Devi, could, you know, you could put it down to Van Gogh, to a lot of those painters who were very, you know, informal. I took my cue actually not from Van Gogh, but I took it from Pranath Mago, who'd taken it from Van Gogh.
In relation to partition.
Yeah, but I mean, actually it was a landscape I painted directly, you know.
You painted directly?
Yeah, yeah. Very, very much so.
You have to swallow, otherwise you just vomit.
Yeah, yeah.
So this idea of, again, going back to memory and your relationship.
No,
I'm quite
sure.
How did you make it?
I was also trying out many things as I'm even now, I think. And I think it was one of the early. I didn't know what to do after partition. We were thrown out. We were in Simla at the time. And I was just looking around, you know. And the way I got the job in the bank was again one of these fortuitous events.
I think what will be lovely if we go downstairs and enjoy chatting further over a drink. But
good.
Yes, and I'm going to have to invite. We have to go down this side for those who are happy to walk down the stairs. Those who need assistance should gather together at this side, and where we'll have helpers to take them across the top of the gallery and down the lift there. But. Please do come and join us for a drink afterwards. But first of all, may I thank Krishen Khanna so much.